Yam Shaivas Samupasate Shivaidi Brahmedi Vedantino Baudha Buddha Idi Pramana Padavaha Karte Dinaya Iga Arhan Nityatha Jaina Shasanarata Karmedi Mimam Saga Soyambo Vidadhatu Vanchita Phalam Trailokyanatho Harihi Soyambo Vidadhatu Vanchita Phalam Trailokyanatho Harihi Divibhumau Tathakashe Behirandaschame Vibhu Yo Vibhatyavabhasatma Tasmai Sarvatmane Namaha Madhya Hridayakashe Sadanandamayo Guru Udetu Sadadam Samyag Ajnanatimirarunaha Arihi Om Jayadu. At least on the way back from Malaysia, I thought I would spend 2 or 3 days in Chennai so that we can be together and discuss a very important subject which everyone in the human society will inevitably like, cherish and would like to be nourished by. The subject today mainly is conflicts of the mind and their redressal or redress through knowledge. This is the subject that we have chosen here. Actually, I would like to discuss Yoga Vasishtha Ramayana, a very important scriptural composition all of you must be familiar with. In our country, there are a number of discourses taking place on our scriptural compositions. Philosophical and spiritual discussions will necessarily have to be on the Upanishads of the Vedas. Then we have the epic dialogue between Krishna and Arjuna which transpired in the battlefield of Kurukshetra, the Bhagavad Gita. There is one more text which is called the Brahma Sutra, which is not so much discussed in the country. Then Shankaracharya and some others have written some Prakarana Granthas propounding the theme of Vedanta and Vedantic thought. These are generally very popular. Then comes Srimad Bhagavatam, which is much less understood than it should have been. It is actually a very beautiful composition in which the entire Upanishadic message is illustrated through a number of explanations on the one hand, discussions and dialogues on the other, and graphic illustrations through epic characters. The whole discussion is centrally focused on Krishna's birth, exploits, and the various occasions in which Krishna spoke to either Arjuna or Uddhava or the others concerned. But all these texts are there in our country, very good. But there is one important composition called Yoga Vasishtha Ramayana, which is written by Valmiki, and it is a dialogue that transpired in Ayodhya Palace for 18 days from morning to evening, as I must have spoken about last year or year before, I mean some other year. This text is a complete discussion on the human mind. I think all the troubles, torments and turmoils that the human mind passes through during man's life in this world can be completely answered and resolved by the Yoga Vasishtha Ramayana Gospels. Mind is actually a subject which nobody knows anything about. Our personality consists of the body, and the body consists of matter. It's a biological aggregate. Medical science is supposed to be dealing with this aggregate in a very thorough manner. The matter inside the skull called the brain has also been medically examined and a lot of research has gone. But when it comes to a question of understanding the consciousness, whose expression is the mind, the entire medical science as well as other objective sciences keep safely away. It is not an item or a product which can be gone into scientifically by objective experimentation. In as much as it is so, what Yoga Vasishtha Ramayana says, and the Upanishads and the other compositions also pose it, we have to accept. All of you have the mind. There is no doubt about it. We feel it. And we are put into trouble by the mind more than we are made delightful. Keeping this mind completely within our body, accessible to every one of you individually and inaccessible to the others. Am I clear? Your mind is accessible only to you and not to the others. According to me, it is a great treasure. It has got infinite potential. Its magnitude is immense. Its magnificence is indescribable. Such a beautiful mind we have, but we are more miserable with the mind than delightful. What is the reason for it? Can any product, anything outside in this world, act directly on the mind? Certainly not. That is why I say the mind is inaccessible to the others. My expression you might have heard. I don't know whether you will understand it instantly, much less will you accept it. But let me make it clear that the mind is inaccessible to the others. It is accessible only to oneself. And this mind is a magnificent, glorious treasure. We are not able to understand it and take it to be so. Yoga Vasishtha Ramayana, through the dialogue between Vasishtha and Sri Rama, repeatedly tells us about this majesty and magnificence of the human mind. Only by understanding the mind properly and trying to unearth its potentials and possibilities, we shall be able to make our life comfortable to ourselves and enriching to the society at large. Keeping all these things in mind, I thought we will discuss the subject of conflicts of the mind and their redress through knowledge. Why is it that we are saying conflicts of the mind? Can there be different types of conflicts? Conflicts of the mind and conflicts of so many other things? I think it is worth going into. People are experiencing a number of conflicts, a variety of them. Where are they originating from? Where are they being sustained by? It is worth going into. Only when you start thinking in this manner, and particularly in a causal manner, we will be able to reach at the genesis of conflicts and think of resolving them through a right knowledge, discrimination, a beautiful wisdom that we can have. Conflicts are a part of human life. Therefore, the understanding of conflicts will necessarily take us to the understanding of human life. All of you are living in this world. If I were to ask you, will you please explain to me what is living? Swamiji, I have not thought about it. I have met many married people. I ask them sometimes, can you tell me why are you married and what is the purpose of marriage? Swamiji, we haven't thought about it. Similarly, when we ask parents, why have you become parents? No proper explanation is there. To do something is different from knowing it well. The knowing process takes place only when you start inquiring into it, introspecting over the subject, employing the mind and intelligence for the purpose. So I think much less do we think. Perhaps we act seemingly more. Evolution takes place, understanding takes place, growth also takes place, primarily in the mind level, in the intelligence level of man. So what is life? According to anybody, life is actually an interaction. It is an interaction between the living individual and the rest of the world. What did I say? It is an interaction between the living individual and the rest of the world. What is meant by the rest of the world? Everything other than him. Interaction with the surrounding air. We breathe constantly and breathe out also. So it's an interaction with the air. We see every object, even nothing is there. We see that there is nothing. It's a visual interaction. We hear a number of words. All these interactions are taking place in the sensory level. What is our body? Viewed spiritually or philosophically in this life, our body is a seat for the senses. Out of the senses, five senses are actional senses. Senses meant for action. Five senses are senses meant for gaining knowledge. The world is apprehended by us only through the five senses, like eyes, ears, nose and the like. And we are acting in this world with our hands we hold, with our legs we walk, with the other respective organs we do their respective activities. So interaction is seemingly on the sensory level. But if you think about it, can the senses by themselves act? Can they by themselves act? A sleeping man, does he see? He must be moving up and down. I mean, turning up and this side and that side. But he never knows that he was moving the body. You may play music before the sleeping man. He may not listen to you. It is not that the ears were closed. Eyes were closed, we can understand. Ears are not closed. But nevertheless, he doesn't hear. What does it mean? So though the interactions are taking place in the sensory level, for all interactions, the mind should connect itself with the senses. So interactions are originating, initiated by the mind. Am I clear of it? Not only the interactions are originated or initiated by the mind, while the interaction is on, is the connection broken? The connection with the mind still remains, continues to be. So the interactions, not alone being initiated by the mind, they also subsist on the mind. Am I clear? They subsist at every point of time on the mind. When the interactions are over, means every action, as time passes, that particular action also passes away, is it not? I am talking to you, you are hearing me, my talk and your hearing both. As I utter every word, I move my lips, I move my hands, I nod my head. All these things are actions, interactions. These interactions, as they express themselves, they also pass away. They become a thing of the past. So the interactional effects and outcome, where are they registered and kept? Why don't you say? In the mind. So what do we understand now? The interactions are originating from the mind. They are initiated by the mind. While the interactions are on, they subsist on the mind. And every interaction, when completed, its consequence or effect is registered in the mind to be kept as a memory which the mind draws when you want or when it wants. Am I clear? So the interactional life, where is it really based on? Is it on the senses or is it in the mind? If it is in the mind, the conflicts that you are reporting and are suffering from, are they sense-born or are they mind-born? Is there any conflict which your nose experiences? All experiences belong to inside personality, the mind, let us say. So as is life interactional, the conflicts which are a resultant or which are inevitable in the course of our interactions also are mind-born, mind-subsisting. And if a solution or a resolution has to be found for conflicts, they have to be found by the mind. That is why we discussed it as conflicts of the mind. When we have arrived at that, conflicts are always of the mind, by the mind, in the mind and for the mind. Now what can penetrate the mind and arrive at some kind of a solution or a redress, you tell me? Something like a balm spread on the body, smeared on the body? The mind can be accessed, if at all, only by the intelligence. The mind can be touched and it can be involved, it can be penetrated only by the intelligence. That is the only tool available for us to get into the mind. In order to study the conflicts, understand their impact and see whether there is any solution or a dissolution for the conflict, we have to employ and activate our intelligence. That is how the subject becomes a discussion like this. Anything of the mind can be clearly analyzed by the intelligence. The intelligence is always known to inquire, to investigate, to examine, to introspect, and then get to know whatever it wants to. That intelligence which you are applying for knowledge of the external objects, the same intelligence as a tool can be applied to get into the mind structure and know what these conflicts are and whether they can be resolved or dissolved. The entire Yoga Vasishtha Ramayana, as I told you, it was discussing, Vasishtha was discussing the problem of Sri Rama's mind. The enquiries, conflicts, puzzles, enigmas, confrontation, discomfiture and the like of Sri Rama's mind. And in the course of 18 days, he completely removed every one of it. The same thing happened in Bhagavad Gita also. There also it took place in the same manner. Now we speak of conflicts. What are these conflicts? You already know, only to make the discussion relevant, I may say something about it. Without conflicts, it is not possible to live in this world. Not at all. Conflicts can be professional. They can be domestic and residential. They can also be religious conflicts, spiritual conflicts. All can be there. Now, one instance to quote, a retarded girl is born in a family. The parents find it very difficult to look after the child. After some time, they will pass away. What can we do? Whose fault is this? How did they have such a child? These are conflicts. Some of my devotees and disciples have such undesirable developments, very tormenting developments in the house. And I have to cheer them up, give them a lot of tuition in order that they are not put into trouble. What will happen? The child will continue to live. They will not live, they will have to die. So questions, religious questions also arise. Did I do some sin that deserved this kind of a punishment? Is the child the child's or is the child ours? This kind of a thought. This happens. There is a daughter who is married, who has gone away. With her husband, she is raising a family. Many years pass and suddenly she gets a message that the mother is seriously sick. She wants to go to the mother. It also happened that her child has been emergently hospitalized in the hospital. As a mother, what she feels for her child, the other mother also feels for her. So she wants to go. She is unable to go. Is it not a conflict? Any doubt? A boy and a girl marry in a lot of fondness. They know each other very well and they have married. After marriage, they for the first time began to live together. Then gradually differences started cropping up. Finally, it ends up in disloyalty and the girl is forced to divorce. Is it a conflict or not? Does it happen? Not in the sannyasin community, but in your householder community. It's not happening with us. So there was a girl who wrote to me once of such a problem when I was in Delhi. So I wrote to her, my dear girl, you know, as sannyasins and people speaking about dharma, we never advocate or uphold divorce. So I cannot tell you that you divorce. But whatever it may be, I can give you support and strength for any of the courses. Somehow you reconcile with the situation and see whether you can go on. If necessary, it is impossible, then you may think of divorce. You may think of a remarriage also. Once bitten, twice shy, it is better not to marry again. But in any way, if you cannot do it, you may do that also. I shall support you and reinforce you for any of these three, I said. Did you understand? Now when such an instance comes, what shall I do? I will have to support the people. I will have to give them strength. It's a great conflict, very difficult. So in any way, this girl ended up in divorce, but she has never married after that. I'm not saying that nobody should marry, I'm only telling you an instance. Now this is one kind of a conflict. I have seen instances where a young husband, particularly in foreign countries, he suddenly dies in an accident. The wife, very young, she has become a long-term widow. She has a suckling child. The mourning period is on. In some instances, I have gone to their houses to console them and give them strength. can she be unmindful of the child? At the same time, can she forget the tragic nature of what has taken place? So the mind is fried in a conflict. Does it happen or not? In the professional life, you have many instances. Promotion is denied, you have an irritable boss, you have a mischievous assistant. So many things are there in professional life. Denial of promotion and many matters that are necessary. I don't have to elaborate it. I would like to tell you, just for the sake of feeling it, you know, we are all seated comfortably in cities and we are citizens. We have a feeling that, oh, we are lovers of the nation. But do you know, if you have to live here peacefully, our borders have to be secure. And a number of military and paramilitary personnel, people are moving about. And in our country, unfortunately, always there is death in the security. Security men are dying. Are we conscious of it? We speak of GDP and other things. But the borders have to be secured. And they are actually giving their life. So I have a disciple whose father retired as a general. He has written a book. So he gave me the book and said, Swamiji, will you read it? So remembering him, I was reading the book. Every day, after 10 o'clock or 10:30, I would read a few pages and I completed the book. I will tell you an instance of what he has written. Would you like to hear? He says that during the Second World War, I had to launch an offensive against the Japanese army. The next morning, he was supposed to march. Air Force was supposed to give him support. Early in the morning, the sun rose, and there was no air support as planned. But he decided to march. He went forward. Later on, it was known that they had no visibility. So how to bomb where? They will be bombing our own men. So they withheld. He said, we went forward. There was heavy fighting, hand-to-hand fighting also. A number of my army people, all of them fell dead. And I had to walk on the bodies of my own men. There was a lump on my throat, but I had no time to honor it. Do you understand? I had no time to honor it. Then somehow the offensive was successful. The Japanese army withdrew, and all of them, normally it would be a moment of elation, etc. Everybody was tired. They wanted to retire. They wanted to take rest and sometimes sleep also. But he said, this is one thing that I could not allow. What? Rest and sleep, I could not allow. So I asked them, make deep bunkers for safety. Are you following me? I don't know, I felt a lot touched by this writing. I could not allow them to rest and sleep, he said. When they were making bunkers, one hand was already cut. It was bleeding. He was pickaxing with another hand. He said, why are you pickaxing? Go away. No, I will complete this and go, he said. Such instances give us a lot of delight and inspiration. This also. This is one kind of a conflict that I thought I would like to share with you. So don't think that we can avoid conflicts in life at all. There will be a number of them, a variety of them. Can there be any greater conflict? So whenever you have a conflict, don't think that mine alone is the greatest. There are so many others. Why don't you go out and compare notes with others or read? Now all these are contemporary developments. Now we have something called epic conflicts. Conflicts described in our epic literature so that they will have a great inspiration and a constant value. It will remain. This story of general, I don't think it can live for more than 100, 200 or 300 years. Those books will be forgotten. Publishers will not publish them at all after some time. Now, our epic literature is not like that. We don't want to change a syllable of that epic composition. So much of love and fervor we have because it has got an eternal relevance. In the epic instance, I would like to tell you about the conflict Kunti Devi suffered from. She had to pack up her firstborn child Karna and float him on the river. She could not forbear the scandal if the child was openly admitted and she proved to be the mother. She did it at midnight without anybody knowing it, held the secret throughout in her life. And when the Mahabharata war was over, and under the leadership of Yudhishthira, all of them, the women and the others, went for doing tarpana, giving water to the departed souls. Kunti Devi rushed there and told Yudhishthira, do tarpana for your elder brother Karna. Yudhishthira said, what? He was shocked. If I had known it beforehand, I would have laid all my resources. I would have prostrated before him and asked him to be our leader. Why did not my mother tell me this all along? He said, I am not going to rule or sit on the throne. I will go to the forest and live on fruits and roots throughout my life. Krishna tried to console him, could not succeed. Finally, he was taken to Bhishma to be consoled. Bhishma, he went to Bhishma lying on the bed of arrows, and by a long conversation, Bhishma was able to set right his mind. This is an epic conflict. Rama decided to go to the forest. Kaikeyi said, no coronation for you today, but straight away go to Dandakaranya for 14 years. Rama said, only this much. And what did Rama have? Anything more than a mind? Rama had a body like you have. He also had a mind. He had an intelligence. It is with these three that he said, I shall go. So what prevents you from saying, I shall also go? If Rama could say this, every one of us must be able to say, is it not? No answer. See, wonderful. Are Rama's mind could pick up the resolution to say, I shall go. It was his mind. It was a great conflict, no doubt. He went and told Kausalya first. She was totally unnerved. But after a little talk, Kausalya said, okay, I am not expecting any other course of action from you. Go. Kausalya was appeased. She blessed him. But Dasharatha could not. Most of you fall under the Dasharatha category, isn't it? But I tell you, there is a Kausalya dimension. It's a question of your option. Would you like to be a Kausalya or would you like to be Dasharatha? So Kausalya reconciled with the conflict and sent him away. Rama, Lakshmana and Sita were seated in the chariot. And Sumantra was driving. Sumantra was a trusted counselor and minister of Dasharatha who was still alive. Dasharatha said, stop the chariot. Rama said, no, speed on. Are you hearing? Rama said, don't stop, speed on. If the king asks you, you tell him, I have not heard. I did not hear. Because any instance of lamentation should not be allowed to linger. Suppose there is misery, anxiety and lamentation. Any such plight should not be allowed to prolong itself. So go. This is what Rama said. Sumantra had the greatest conflict at that time. In the Kurukshetra episode also, what is happening? 45 lakhs of warriors, fighters were there. And Arjuna came there after 13 years of preparation. Not that it was an unknown development. Actually, he was very anxious to be on that occasion. Then suddenly Arjuna went into a crisis. Total crumbling of his personality took place. And Sri Krishna dealt with it for about 2 or 3 hours. It was a conflict, no doubt. But was not Arjuna enabled to forbear the conflict and go forward? Yes or no? So is it possible for us to forbear the conflict and go forward? Or we will all be undone by it, subdued by it, suppressed by it? Our mind has got enough of flexibility, enough of catholicity, enough of expanse, enough of depth, enough of magnitude. Any extent of power this mind can imbibe, culture and develop. This is what I want to tell you. We generally know only about the conventional notes of the mind. What? Conventional notes. Nobody thinks originally. Nobody probes into the mind to find out, is it bigger than the body or smaller? That kind of a thought never occurs to us. Our body is very limited. But inside the body, there is a mind. Mind is not matter. What? Mind is not. Body is made up of matter and energy. The mind is totally different from the body, unlike matter and energy. So the matter energy aggregate called the body, if it is limited, the mind that is associated with it, should it be limited or will it be unlimited? All of you agree or disagree? It is true that mind experiences conflicts during the course of the interactional life. But the mind can certainly withstand any kind of a conflict and still go forward, assimilate it and make it an enrichment. That is certainly possible. The instance of Rama, Krishna, Arjuna, all of them are there. We honor them. We honor Sri Rama. We honor Krishna. We also honor Arjuna. Is it because they were completely undone by the conflicts, or they were able to forbear them and go still forward in life doing great and greater things? So what is the strength of life? The strength of life is the extent of conflicts you are able to bear and go forward successfully. This is what we want. And all these conflicts are taking place in the level of the mind. So in order to withstand the conflicts, assimilate them. The moment the conflicts are assimilated, they become enrichment to you. What did I say? The moment we are able to assimilate them, the word assimilation is such that you digest it. Suppose the food given to the stomach, the alimentary canal digests, then it becomes nourishment, energy that is available to you for being active in this world. In the same manner, when conflicts are assimilated by the mind, that assimilational process results in enrichment and empowerment. Is it clear or not? So what should you try when you are faced with conflicts? Never try to flee from conflicts. Never be afraid of them. On the other hand, understand that the mind has got enough dimension, enough magnitude, enough flexibility, enough assimilational power, assimilating power, so that all conflicts can be completely of an enriching kind. This is the message I would like to tell all of you. This is what Yoga Vasishtha upholds and repeatedly tells you. Arjuna's instance was a sudden one. In the case of Parikshit, about which all of you know, Parikshit did a great mistake in putting a dead cobra on the neck of the Shamiga Maharshi, and he got a curse from the Maharshi's son. It was something very bad, but he had 7 days time before dying. In the 7 days, Shukamuni came and narrated Srimad Bhagavata to him, as a result of which his mind became absolutely expansive, the intelligence became illumined, and he was able to forestall the effects of Takshaka's bite. Finally, the body was consumed by the fire which arose from the poison, is what Srimad Bhagavata says. But before that, Parikshit had already withdrawn himself and got into that soul magnificence. In the case of Sri Rama, he was very young. Arjuna was a middle-aged man. Parikshit was an elderly king, and Sri Rama was still young, 16 years old. He got out of the palace of Ayodhya for the first time on a pilgrimage, and he wandered, he traveled throughout the subcontinent of India, trying to know the plight of the people in general. For the first time, he got out from the palace, and when he knew all about, this is the plight of mankind, plight of humanity, he was completely overpowered by what he saw. I'm not going to describe it, possibly I had described it earlier. Then he came back a totally different person. At that time, Vasishtha called him through Dasaratha and said, "My dear son, what are you suffering from?" Then Sri Rama poured forth everything in his mind. "This is the type of life I find spread out before me. Individuals are behaving in this manner. Groups are behaving in another manner. The entire society seems to be infatuated. What shall I do? What shall I depend upon? Where is my refuge? I am not able to know anything. I am suffering from conflicts. I don't know what I am to do. I would prefer death. I don't want to live at all." This is what he said. Then he was treated. Vasishtha Dev took about 18 days to treat Sri Rama's mind. 18 days. That 18-day dialogue, the dialogue, that prince-sage dialogue, what? The prince-sage dialogue. If you can imbibe some of these lessons and the messages in your life, I think you will have a very beautiful mind. You will never fear any kind of a life situation at all. Any kind of a life situation, you will never fear. Be poised for assimilating all the conflicts, the convenience in your mind. So, does the body cause conflict or does the mind cause? Mind causes the conflicts. So, in order to redress them, where shall we approach? The mind itself. How can we approach the mind? Through the intelligence. And what is the way of approaching the intelligence? Through knowledge. Set up questions, take up inquiry, do investigations, do introspection, do self-examination, hear more and more about the potential of the mind, the possibilities of the mind, more and more about it. Then you will find our mind imbibes more and more qualities, beautiful qualities. Unfortunately, that mind culture, mind sublimation, mind enrichment, mind empowerment, the qualities of the mind, we are not generally sensitive about, we are not concerned with. See, I am telling you a few words. Everywhere, in every walk of life, we have words like what? Commitment, dedication, trustworthiness, accountability, reliability, perseverance, fervor, enthusiasm. All these are words relating to implying mind's qualities. How will you imbibe these qualities? How will you develop them? What is the methodology for it? You are all parents, most of you. Have you ever told your children anything about the mind? Why? What is the reason? Have you yourself done any kind of an examination? What are these conflicts? Why am I suffering in this manner? And where is the redress, if at all, available? So this kind of an inquiry should be there. Should be there. So whenever I talk, I say this is called interactional mathematics. Certainly this is mathematics. So Sri Rama makes one or two observations which I thought I will discuss today. Chitta dimani sukha dukha shatani nunam abhyagatanyagavaradivakananani tasmin viveka vashadastanudam prayade manye mune nipuname vagalanditani. After having said whatever he had to say, Sri Rama sums it up. Chitta dimani sukha dukha shatani nunam. Hundreds and thousands of comfort and discomfort, happiness and misery, sukha and dukkha, all of them are born of the mind. Is it clear? You have a nice cup of tea and it gives you a comfort. Can you tell me this comfort is from the tea or from the mind? You will not easily agree. That is the trouble. I will make you agree. See, a person having typhoid, the tongue is coated. He likes the tea very much. Let him drink tea. Will it have taste? Where is it gone? The world appears to be what it is because of our senses. Are you agreeing? It is the eyes that make colorful objects. The objects by themselves are not colorful at all. It is our eyes that make them colorful. It is our eardrum that makes sounds. Suppose the five senses are taken away from our body, will you ever be able to see the world as it is now? So the world is colored by the senses, or the senses are colored by the world? I think you must be sensitive enough. If in place of the present eyes, we had another type of eyes, I think the color situation would also have been different. So these senses are made by the world, or these are made by the inlying power in the body? Nobody has thought about it. See, your eyes, your brain, your nose, your hands, your feet, all these are shaped by the inside power called the soul, or by something else. If our senses are made, that is what we call the mind. The mind is actually an expression of the soul, an expression of what you call God. It is that mind that has formulated all the body and the bodily parts. So that these senses are making the world, they are reading the world. So whatever the world appears to be, it is simply because of our mind. Chitta adimani sukha dukkha shatani nunam. So thousands and thousands of sukha dukkhas, all are born of the mind. Abhyagatanyagavaradivakananani. He gives an example. There is a huge mountain like Himalayas or Mount Meru. As you will find the huge Himalayas, in the surrounding region, there will be a number of hills and hillocks will be there. In the same manner, mind is having the position of Himalayas, and all these sukhadukhas are like the hillocks surrounding. Tasmin vivegavashatastanutam prayade. This mind, if you are able to subject it into an examination by viveka, viveka means discrimination. If you are able to subject it to an examination of viveka, discrimination, as we are doing now, manye mune nipuname vagalanditani, all these sukadukhas will simply fall. You will attain a state of homogeneity. You will attain a state of uniformity, a beautiful sublimity enrichment in your mind, so that there will be no conflicts at all in your life. It is something like climbing a few heights, one or two steps more. There will not be any situation where you will feel totally dejected, despondent, overpowered or undone. Maybe strange developments may be there. Some developments may be a little unfortunate also. In spite of it, our mind will have sufficient capacity, sufficient ability and sufficient readiness to meet any kind of a situation, assimilate it, be enriched and go forward. Chittam karanamarthanam tasmin sadi jagatrayam tasmin kshine parikshinam tachigitsyam prayatnatah. This proposition you may not easily accept and act upon. Chittam, the mind, karanamarthanam. Mind alone is the cause of objects and materiality. Mind alone is the cause of all materiality. All the objects are only when the mind is there. If the mind is not there, there will be no objects at all. I shall discuss it perhaps in greater length tomorrow. Tasmin sadi jagatrayam. When the mind is there, all the three worlds are there. Tasmin kshine parikshinam. When the mind is treated and it is made thin and light, everything goes. Tat chigitsyam prayatnatah. This mind is to be treated with effort, with perseverance. This is what Sri Rama concludes in his dialogue. I will summarize what I have said. Life is interactional. Interactions proceed from the mind, they subsist on the mind, they also conclude and terminate in the mind. So all interactions are, primarily speaking, mind-born, mind-subsisting and mind-sustained. So any kind of a conflict with reference to any object situation, it really has its genesis in the mind. It is impossible to live in this world without conflicts. All that we have to do is make our mind more and more broad, more and more deep, more and more lofty, and more empowered, as a result of which any kind of a situation it will be able to assimilate without any fatigue whatsoever. I always quote one instance. Not now, but a few years back, the philosophy with our family people was give birth to 12 children. I have seen mothers who have delivered up to 10. Have you thought about it? The mother looks after 12 children, but she has only 24 hours and two hands. With 24 hours and two hands a day, how did she look after 12 children? And that was considered to be a great glory. Only I think so, or you also think? This is what you people have told me. Now you tell me, this expansive motherhood, was it a bodily development or a mental development? Now with two children, our mothers are shrinking. Just see, you know, in such houses you will find two children will be always sick. They will be laid up with fever. The mother accepts that, now and then goes to them, gives them some kind of a medicine or this, that and all, and she will be carrying on with the other work. So don't set limits to the mind. According to me, sky is the limit. Mind can grow to any extent. At the age of 21, the body has completed its growth. Thereafter, to grow, there is only mind and intelligence. And there is no limit at all. You can always grow, always grow. Yoga Vasishtha tells you, whoever feels that I have got shackles in my mind and I want to get away from them, for such a person is this dialogue best suited. Aham baddho vimuktasyam idiyasya asti nischayaha natyandamajno nodajnaha sosmin shastre dhigaravan. I am bound, I am suffering from so many shackles made by the mind and intelligence. I want to get free of them. Whoever has this kind of a resolution, and who is not fully ignorant, and who is not very greatly knowledgeable, people in the middle level, for them this shastra is relevant and applicable, he says. So this is the subject that we are going to discuss. We shall stop the discourse today. Kartavyamasti namameha nakinchi deva sthadavyamityadimanaha bhuvi samsthidosmi samshamdaya sadada supta dhyaiva vrtya karyam karomi nachakinjidaham karomi karyam karomi nachakinjidaham karomi. Harihi Om, Harihi Om, Harihi, Harihi.